Okay. Hello, everyone. Let's get started. Today, we are going to continue our discussion of unsupervised learning, and in particular of dimensionality reduction. Right, so just to bring everyone back to the same page, right? We want to figure out a way of taking some usually high-dimensional data set consisting of a bunch of vectors in some high-dimensional space, right, and embed them in a low-dimensional space. Right, we discussed various applications of why you may want to care about this, such as visualization or feature discovery, representation learning. Right, and in particular, we are looking at approaches that learn an explicit mapping, F, from a high-dimensional to a low-dimensional space. All right, and that means we have to choose a particular family of mappings or functions to consider, and we have to express a preference about which kind of mapping we would like, right, to formulate an optimization problem and then solve it somehow, right? And we worked through this last lecture in the context of linear dimensionality reduction, right, where we are looking for functions f that are linear in the model parameters, right, like linear regression, but in general, you'll not just output a single dimension, but k dimensions, right, where k would be some small number, much less than d. And one of the topics that we looked at is to think about what is even the right way of expressing preferences over such mappings, right? What kind of functions should we look for, right? And in contrast to supervised learning, that typically we have a particular prediction problem in mind that we want to solve, say classification or regression, and where we would consequently be given a loss function that we care about, like square loss, right, or sort of one loss, right, accuracy, etc. In unsupervised learning, we don't a priori have a clear goal, right? And so the perspective that I presented and motivated in the last lecture was essentially this view on unsupervised learning as compression, right? We somehow want to learn mappings that somehow compress the data well, right? And one way to formulate this is to basically look for mappings that allow us to reconstruct the original data, preferably with little loss, right? And so in the linear setting, this led us to the principal component analysis problem, where we basically jointly optimize over our mapping, right, our matrix W, as well as the coordinates set I of the dimensionality reduced points, right? And so we wanted to essentially solve for these parameters, right, that describe our subspace and the coordinates on that subspace in a way such that this dimensionally reduced representation faithfully allows us to reconstruct the original data, right, and measured in terms of squared loss, right? So if we look at essentially where are the points on the subspace spent by W and compare them with the original points, we want to have a small reconstruction error. Right, and this led us basically to this principal component analysis problem. The optimization problem is given here. Even though it's phrased as optimizing W and the set, the coordinates jointly, you really only, the degrees of freedom really only are these weights W, because for a given matrix W, the coordinates are given, right? So basically just a projection on the subspace spent by W. And this, in fact, results in a linear mapping, right? So the kinds of functions that you now consider are basically functions f of x, right, that are given by W transpose x, right? So this is the problem that we derived. We've seen that this optimization problem here actually has a very nice closed-form solution in terms of an eigenvalue problem, right? So we were able to obtain this matrix W from the covariance matrix of our data, right? So basically the leading principal eigenvectors of our covariance matrix of the data, right? So basically capturing sort of the principal axes of variation in the data. Okay? And also I had this remark, and we'll come back to this, is that the way we derived now PCA is actually ends up being very similar to the k-means problem that we had talked about before, right? So you can actually view both of them as optimizing one and the same objective, namely the scarce reconstruction error, just with a bit of different constraints, right? And in PCA, we only constrain the points to live on the subspace, but otherwise allow continuous coordinates on that subspace, right? That's why we get sort of this real-valued response coordinates, dimensionally reduced coordinates, versus in k-means, we force our point representation to be exactly equal to one of the clusters that we've picked, right? So we get this discrete sort of classification-like representation of all our data points, right? But essentially, the constraints are a bit different, but the objective is the same, right? So find a simpler representation, sort of a low-dimensional representation, that allows us to reconstruct the original data as measured by the squared loss. Okay, what we then also talked about is shortcomings, right? We're just working with linear models in the original space, right? And as for linear classification, just using linear models on the original space is somewhat limited, right? So there's certainly plenty of data sets that are not linearly separable, and there's benefits to be gained by looking at nonlinear hypotheses, right? And the first way to do this is to still look at linear hypotheses, but apply to nonlinearly transformed data, right? And the way we discussed this in supervised learning was via the use of nonlinear feature maps, right? And that was this kernel trick that allowed us to sort of implicitly work with them, right? So we could work with very high dimensional feature spaces, where sort of there's a single feature map that sort of is very, very rich and captures a very general class of functions, right? And what we've sort of arrived last lecture was basically a kernelized version of the principal components analysis problem, right? That was sort of the end of the last lecture. It's a bit of a complicated slide, but we derived it last lecture, right? So this hopefully is all familiar, right? And we saw that essentially by using the same ansatz that we used in supervised learning, namely that our mapping is basically, so our solution is in the span of the data, right? We can start looking at this dual parameterization, where we have one coefficient for each data point, and then somehow we rearrange the objective in a way that data points only appear as inner products that can be replaced by a kernel, right? So it was basically playing exactly the same machinery that we've done in the context of the support vector machine, that we've done in the context of kernelized linear regression, et cetera. So here's just another application of that exact same idea, but now for an unsupervised learning problem. Okay, so that's basically kernel PCA. And it also is solved via an eigenvalue problem, a generalized eigenvalue problem, right? So that's the optimization problem we derived. We didn't prove that this is the optimal solution. I'm not going to do this in this class, right? It's a slightly more complicated variant of the argument that we've used in order to prove that PCA was given by the principal eigenvectors, right? So hopefully it's not too surprising. So basically now the representation we get, right? So the coefficients alpha that now parameterize our principal components are given via an eigen decomposition of the covariance matrix, of the kernel matrix. Okay, so that's basically kernel PCA, right? So it's sort of almost exactly like PCA, only that we now not look at the empirical covariance of the data, but the kernel matrix. And moreover, we have to be a bit careful with scaling, right? We have to scale by 1 over lambda I, where lambda I is sort of the ith eigenvalue of that covariance matrix. Okay, but that's really the only change. Okay, and so this gives us the kernel PCA problem, right? And how to basically solve it, right? So we take the kernel matrix, we solve this eigen decomposition, do the scaling, right? And this now gives us our coefficients alpha, right? This is sort of the last slide that we had in the last lecture. Just wanted to bring up everyone up to speed and finish that discussion, and then we'll move on to other nonlinear dimension reduction techniques. Okay, so one thing we haven't talked about is what actually is the nonlinear representation, right? The function f that we end up looking at, right? And so this is basically f of x, right? Before this was just W transpose x, right? So in the linear case, right, this was W transpose x. And now, of course, this is W transpose phi of x, because we work with feature maps, right? And now we expand by plugging in the ansatz for our kernel matrix. So in particular, let me just do this row by row, right? So let me actually spell out fi, right? The ith output dimension in the dimensionality reduced representation. So this is just the ith row of my matrix W, right? So the ith principal component, right, that we need to multiply with our feature representation of x, right? And now this is simply the sum, right? So we plug in the definition of wi, which is the sum over j equals 1 through n of alpha j from the ith component, right? This is this guy here, right? That we worked out of phi right, so previously we would use our feature map and applied it to the JS data point, right? So this is just wi transpose phi of x, right? And now obviously we can just rearrange things. So this just gives us sum over j equals 1 through n of alpha j, the ith component, right? So for the ith principal component, and now we have the kernel of xj with x, right? Which is the inner product of phi of xj and phi of x, right? And so these kinds of functions should look very familiar to you, right? They're the types of functions we always worked with when dealing with kernel methods, right? So kernel linear regression. So it's exactly the same types of hypotheses that we had before, right? So in kernel, if sort of kernelized linear regression, right? Kernel rich regression is sort of the supervised model. This is sort of the unsupervised analog of kernel rich regression. Okay, any questions to this? So now it should be clear how the problem, so basically, what's the problem, right? And how in principle one can solve it, right? So in order to apply kernel PCA, what you have to do is you have to pick a kernel, right? And along with it, the parameters. Then you would compute the kernel matrix, you compute the eigendecomposition, take the k leading eigenvectors. These are the alphas, right? By scaling them appropriately. And then each of them defines a nonlinear function fi, right? And again, right, so the types of functions, we've discussed how they look, right? So if you take the Gaussian kernel, this is going to be some sort of weighted nearest neighbor kind of function that we have, right? And the alpha coefficients alpha are optimized to minimize the reconstruction error. Okay, is this any questions about the algorithm? So that's kernel PCA, right? It's basically you just spelled out in LaTeX. An illustration, I'll just go through the demo again in a moment, right? So this the original data set on the left is this two rings data set. If you just do PCA, you get garbage, right? So the, all directions of equal variance, right? It's very isotropic. But if you do kernel PCA with the Gaussian kernel in a particular length scale, and you look at the two principal components, then you get the embedding on the right, right? And now that sort of nicely linearly separates the data. And so, for example, if you now were to use this as a feature to just train a linear classifier on top of that data set, right, it would be now linearly separable, right? Or if you think about solving some sort of clustering problem on top of that data set, you sort of at least have the data here in sort of, it seems more plausible, right, that you can use something like k-means, right? Maybe it's not ideally suited in this case here for k-means, right? Because it's not really nice spherical clusters of the same size, right? But it sort of starts looking something more reasonable. Okay, and in fact, now I haven't talked about this, right? But so basically kernel PCA is sort of the kernelized version of PCA. And then you can ask, well, we've discussed k-means, and k-means is so closely related to PCA, is there sort of a kernelized version of k-means? And if you derive it, it's basically k-means sort of applied on this kernel PCA representation of the data. Okay, that's kernel k-means. And it's very closely related to Well, you can view it as an instance of a larger family of clustering algorithms called spectral clustering. Okay, and I mean spectral decomposition, eigendecomposition of the kernel matrix. That's where the name comes from. Okay, so let's just take a look at this. So I've shown you this. So this is this clustering demo that we had. Let me plot this, right? So this was here our nice sort of k-means ideal problem, right? If we pick three clusters, right, and solve k-means, say via the k-means plus plus algorithm, it's going to have no problems whatsoever. But if you take data sets like this one here, right, this circles data set, which you told me has two clusters, right? So k-means would not find those two clusters, right? But if you apply kernel sort of k-means, which is basically you do kernel PCA with the Gaussian kernel, suitably chosen length scale, and then you apply k-means on that resulting representation, you get this clustering, right? It's basically the same k-means algorithm, right, but now in kernel space. Okay, so now this gives you a much richer family of cluster structures that you can capture. Right, and so we could go to, so that's the two moons data set, right? That again, you get garbage if you just apply standard isotropic k-means, right? So it's not nice spherical data, right? So this is k-means is not going to work. And that's not a local optimum, right? So this is really how the globally optimal solution looks like. But if you would apply it with the RBF kernel, the sort of nearest neighbor-based kernel, then you get this nice nice representation, right? And so, okay, so clearly if there's no cluster structure, it'll not suddenly make up some. Here, okay, so I haven't, there's just a single hyperparameter value I've chosen for the length scale. And of course, now that's a tuning parameter, right, that you'll have to pick somehow. And now you, right, so this is, of course, a question of how you set it. And again, this is a bit of a problem, right? So as we said, for supervised learning, you have cross-validation, you know what's your target, right? On the validation set, what you want to optimize. Here for unsupervised learning, it's not so clear, right? I mean, what's the right criterion to optimize? We talked about various different things like the elbow and these sort of regularized quantization error kind of metrics, right? And you can apply the same. I haven't done this here. So the demo just uses a fixed kernel parameter. So this is maybe not the optimal choice, but it still does something better on this data set even than if you just were to use, I guess here it doesn't make so much difference. Okay. Weird variance, right? Okay. Anyways, so basically, okay, so you can add the number of clusters, right? So, so it certainly captures much richer cluster structure than naively applying k-means on this data set, okay? So this is just applying basically kernel k-means with the Gaussian kernel. Now there's this more generally family of spectral clustering methods that you can motivate by sort of using other types of affinity matrices, right, that actually don't necessarily come from positive definite kernel functions. And so this is this basically gives you similar results on these types of data sets. And it's sort of a bit more robust, right, also for, okay, so we can maybe take, gives arguably slightly better results on these types of data sets that we had talked about before. Okay, so this is very, very similar kind of algorithm, right, but not plugging Gaussian kernel, but sort of a nearest neighbor kernel. So you essentially look at, connect the data points in the graph, and then you construct an affinity matrix that's basically looking at this nearest neighbor graph, and then you look at the eigendecomposition of that graph. I'm not going to define and discuss this algorithm in such much more detail. I want to point out there's this more general family of clustering approaches called spectral clustering. And this is sort of an instance an important instance of those. Okay, so what is this here? This is PCA. Here's an example of applying kernel PCA on this original two spheres dataset, and so on. So I'll post those notebooks online, and you can play around with this and experiment a bit with it. Okay, so one thing I want to briefly talk about. we derived PCA under the assumption that the data was centered, right? So basically, that the data has zero mean, right? And this led us to look at the empirical covariance matrix of the data, right? And allowed us to derive the principal components by looking at the empirical covariance matrix of the data. Now, one thing we haven't discussed in the derivation of kernel PCA is what happens with the centering. Because if you apply this nonlinear transformation, the mean doesn't necessarily have to be the same. Okay? And so in general, actually computing the mean in kernel space might be a bit problematic. And so there's basically ways of doing something like the centering operation directly in kernel space. And so this is here one particular way to do it. So it's the default centering operation applied to the kernel matrix. I just wanted to point that out. Okay, and again, in terms of use cases, we set sort of one nice use case of kernel PCA beyond just visualizing the data. Is this feature discovery, right? It's basically trying to come up with nonlinear low-dimensional feature representations of a data set that you can then, for example, use downstream for classification. Yes? So that might be an artifact of sort of the centering, sort of. That sort of one is blown up more than the other, or is
that? Yeah, so by centering, yeah.
So the issue is you don't know, the feature space is infinite dimensional in this case. It's sort of hard to visualize really what that means, right? But basically, the assumption of PCA, right, is that the data is centered, right? This has zero mean, right? And here now, if you just apply this kernel map, I mean, so what we did is basically we derived what PCA would have done, right? If I plug in this ansatz, right, that my solution lives in the span of the data, right? And we derived it from there, but we didn't explicitly enforce the centering condition, right? And so this is sort of a heuristic approach that that is often applied in practice. That sometimes does help. Okay. So also here, in terms of a bit of intuition, right? How do these dimension-reduced representations really look like? So if you do standard PCA, you might take, say, a plane and project it down to one dimension. Right, so if this is the first principal component, is there any questions? Okay, so if this is here the first principal component, then essentially what happens is that everything that's orthogonal to this principal component is going to be mapped to the same point on the one-dimensional subspace. Right, so you essentially lose all information along the orthogonal complement of that subspace, right? And of course, if the data lives close to this one-dimensional subspace, then you don't lose too much information. That's sort of the idea. And if you go to high dimensions, of course, right? So if you go to this nonlinear setting, right, the kernel PCA setting, then no longer you talk with linear functions, right? So it means that now we have nonlinear manifolds that get projected that end up in the same point on the original space. That's sort of how you might think about this, right? So in the original space, you might even start, say, in a two-dimensional domain, right, and apply a kernel PCA to map it possibly to even a higher dimensional space, right? So even a 20-dimensional space or something like this, right? With the hope that on that transformed space, now the on this transformed space, you would then apply basically a standard PCA, right? So the fact that you sort of orthogonally project on the principal components is only applied in feature space, right? And if you do the inverse mapping, if you sort of look at which points get projected to the same point, then of course those correspond to nonlinear manifolds, right? And that's illustrated here. Okay. So that's basically the idea. So kernel PCA. So kernel PCA is sort of the natural kernelized analog of things like of basically the PCA algorithm, right? And very much in spirit of the kernelized support vector machine or kernelized ridge regression, etc., right? But of course, it suffers from the same shortcomings, right? That means you actually have to specify a kernel. But there are these rich, right, feature maps that are implicitly used when using a kernel like the Gaussian kernel, right? So you do work with very rich representations. But of course, still, the choice of kernel clearly does affect the kinds of representations that you deal with, right? And that can be a limitation. And of course, there's the additional limitation that you do have to work with kernel matrices, which can be large objects, right? So quadratic in the size of the data set. And then you have to do an eigendecomposition, right, of that kernel matrix, which naively at least is some cubic operation, et cetera, right? So there's a scalability issue as well. Okay? And that's sort of very similar to the issues that we had when dealing with kernel methods in the supervised setting, right? And as an alternative to dealing with nonlinear hypotheses that we considered in the supervised setting, right, were neural networks, where we went to look at specific feature maps that were nonlinear, but parameterized in a way that we can try to tune their parameters. Right, that's the idea behind neural nets. And you can try to apply the exact same idea in the unsupervised setting as well. And that that leads to what's called autoencoders, neural network autoencoders. And that's what I want to talk about next. So what are neural network autoencoders? So basically, they can be motivated from the same viewpoints that we use to explain PCA and k-means, right? So what one way to view k-means and PCA, as we argued, is to find a compressed representation, say low-dimensional subspace and coordinates of the points on it, that allow to reconstruct the original data with little loss. And if you take that spirit, right, you can basically motivate autoencoders. And sort of the idea is that you somehow want to learn a mapping that compresses your data while losing as little information as possible, which you can then use as supervisory signal in a way similar to PCA and k-means. Okay, and so one way to view this is to essentially think about the problem of compression as the problem of sort of trying to learn the identity function. Okay, so basically if you have data x, what you can try to do is you can try to learn a function f that is approximately the identity on x. Now, the identity is a very simple function to learn, right? Obviously, you know what the identity is. But the whole point is by keeping the function f not only similar to the identity function, but also keeping it simple in some way, you can get compression. Okay, and so the way this is concretely done is by basically thinking about this purported identity function f as the composition of two functions, f1 and f2, each of which are nonlinear functions, maybe, right? Such that they approximately give you the identity. Okay, so and the idea is that you have this first function f, f1, that would map x in the original space to, would map rd to rk. It's called the encoder. And then you have a function f2 that would take whatever f1 encoded, right? So that now lives on rk and gives back something in rd. That's the decoder. Okay? And both of these are functions that have some tuning parameters we can optimize over. And now, by essentially trying to search for those functions such that F1 composed with F2 behaves approximately like the identity, the only way for that to happen is for F1 to sort of preserve essential information about the data, right? Because if F1 is complete, is not informative about X, then whatever it outputs can't be used in order to reconstruct X. That's the motivation. Okay? And now, of course, the question is, which kind of nonlinear functions would you want to pick? And there's lots of possible functions you could pick, right? But what's done in neural network autoencoders is to basically pick neural nets for functions F1 and F2. Because they're fairly rich families of nonlinear functions, right? And we can compute their gradients and do gradient-based optimization. Right? And so that means that now we have the two functions here. Right, so basically, V is this intermediate representation. Let me actually call this, maybe to avoid confusion, let's call this set here. Okay, so that's the same latent code that we've used for PCA and k-means, right? Set is F1 of X with some parameters theta 1. Let's just call them W1, right? And then you would say x hat is F2 applied to set. Okay, W2, right? And so this is here our usual representation, right? So some nonlinearity of W1 times x, right? Maybe 1. And this is some possibly also nonlinearity phi 2 applied to W2 times set. Okay? And now, right, what you do is you basically try to solve a supervised learning problem, optimizing over your weights, W1 and W2, in order to make X similar to X hat. Yes? Sure. Sure. Sure, absolutely. So now the question is sort of, do we want to sort of tie these weights together in some way or the other, right? Now there's a whole different family of architectures, right? This is sort of the simplest possible model you can consider, right? So in general, you might want to, first of all, not just look at a single layer, right, but multiple layers, right? Then you might use specialized architectures like convolutional layers, for example, right, or other types of layers. And now, so in principle, you could consider various forms of tying weights together. I don't think in general you'll have to do this. So we'll talk about one particular connection where the weights are sort of naturally shared. But so in principle, these are just basically gives you a family of neural networks that you would then optimize, right? But basically the idea is that sort of take this perspective of unsupervised learning equals compression and use essentially this perspective to derive a supervisory signal, right? So we basically try to learn an encoding that allows us to reconstruct the input, which is something that we can actually optimize. Okay, so that's basically neural network autoencoders, right? The artificial neural nets, where there's one output unit for each of the inputs, right? So you have exactly the same number of outputs as inputs, right? And they're responsible, right? So sort of recovering the corresponding input dimensions. And now the question is sort of how many hidden units would you use? Of course, there's lots of possible architectures. So in this simple setting, right? So what's generally important, right, is that you enforce this compression somehow, right? So essentially, one way to do it, and the typical way to do it, is to have a bottleneck, to sort of have few hidden units, so fewer than the output, with sort of the idea that if you somehow go through this bottleneck, are able to reconstruct X from the input via the small number of hidden units, this low-dimensional latent code, then you sort of preserve the most important information about the input. Now, that said, it's actually not the only thing to do. So there's architectures for autoencoders where the number of hidden units is actually much larger than the inputs. So that can make sense as well. But then you need to have proper regularization. So for example, there's sparsity encouraging autoencoders, where you would use the latent code that's much higher dimensional than the input, but then you would use sparsity encoding regularizers, something like the lasso and regression, to ensure that only few of the latent coordinates activate. Okay, so the most important thing is that you encode somehow simplicity in the architecture, right? Your preference for having simple functions, right? So the identity function, if you could, were able to perfectly reproduce the identity function on your training data, that's the perfect recipe for overfitting, right? Because it means you perfectly reproduce the noise in your data. Okay, so you have to fit the function that's sort of simple enough to be able to generalize. Okay. Yeah, then now you want to essentially solve the supervised learning problem where you predict the input from the input, right? As well as you can while sort of having this bottleneck, right? So it's few hidden layers, right? That's sort of an illustration of this here, right? Where that's the input, here's sort of the hidden layer, here's the output, right? And this is sort of the reconstructed output. I'll show you some other examples later. Okay, now how do you train these models? Well, as you said, you basically look at training these models through the lens of supervised learning. Right, since our goal is to now to reconstruct the input, we have a supervisory signal. Right, you want to reconstruct our original X, right? And so it means you can use any loss function that quantifies how well are you able to reconstruct the input from the output. So for example, if you care about mean squared error in your reconstruction, then you might take the squared loss. Right, that's basically the same loss function that we discussed in the context of least squared regression. With the only difference is that you now not just have a single output, but you have d outputs, right? One for each input dimension, right? So in this case, you basically would have to look at the, right? So this is the just the sum. Just the definition of the two norm squared, right? So this would now sum from j equals 1 through d of xi comma d, sorry, xi comma j, so the jth coordinate, compared with the output of the jth function that you learn applied to the ith input example. Right, just the definition of the squared Euclidean norm. So each of them is basically the squared loss. Right, so this is the usual squared loss that we've discussed all along in regression. So training autoencoders, sort of in the standard form, is basically like linear regression, right? With neural network, sorry, not with nonlinear, sort of least squares regression, right? With nonlinear basis functions. Okay, but in principle, you could use other loss functions as well, right? So if you don't care about the square loss, so for example, if you were to reconstruct the binary vector, right, you can think of it as a classification problem, right? So imagine sort of reconstructing handwritten digits, right, that are black and white, right? So every entry in your vector is now 0 or 1. You can view it as a classification problem, right? And now you could use a loss function that comes from classification for each output dimension. Okay, and now that gives you a cost function which you can optimize and use the standard techniques to optimize it, right? Stochastic gradient descent and variance. Now, one thing I want to point out is that training these autoencoders can be tricky sometimes, so especially sort of deep models, right? So the initialization of these models is actually quite tricky. Okay, and so there's quite a bit of work and sort of different ways of initializing these models in some way. I will not discuss those in too much detail here. Okay? So for example, there's some proposals of training them sort of layer by layer and concatenating the resulting models, and use that as initialization that you would then fine-tune using gradient descent. Okay, but so conceptually, the problem that they would solve is essentially this sort of nonlinear regression problem, trying to predict the input from the input. Okay, so how does this relate to stuff we've seen? Well, so it turns out it's actually very closely related to PCA, not just from this motivation of minimizing the compression error, but in fact, it's equivalent for certain choices of parameters. So in particular, if you choose the linear activation functions, then fitting a neural network autoencoder is in fact equivalent to PCA. Okay, so if you choose F1, so the encoder, right? F1 of x, if you choose this simply as W1, let me write transpose x here because that's the consistent notation that we had in the context of PCA, then F2 of x as W2 transpose z, right? So this is of z. And then solve this autoencoder optimization problem, so optimizing over these matrices, then the optimal solution of W1 is given by PCA. So basically, if you have k hidden units, then you basically get W1 by just taking the k principal eigenvectors of your empirical covariance matrix, again, assuming centered data, right? And W2 is just W1 transpose. Okay, so this maybe relates to the question that was asked before, right? So whether it makes sense to tie these weights together. So in this case here, you actually do recover the optimal solution, even if you basically tie W2 to be the transpose of W1. Of course, that's a sort of a very simplified model, right? Just really the linear model. But that's sort of related to this Weichiring question that was asked before. Okay, so that's an important connection, right? So basically, if you think about neural network autoencoders with linear nonlinearities, you get PCA. Yeah? Sure. Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
So, how are we able to distinguish between noise and stuff if we are talking about
supervised? Sure. So the whole point is by encoding the right bias in your function, right? So here, for example, if you think about the linear setting, right? You would pick k less than d. Right? That means F1 really projects down to a k-dimensional subspace. Right? And all the information that's on the orthogonal complement of that k-dimensional subspace is lost. So there's information that really is lost. And now if you believe that your noise lives in this orthogonal complement, and your signal is sort of along this the subspace, then this is sort of a way to denoise. Right? And in the nonlinear case, it's sort of the intuition is the generalization of that idea. Okay, so by basically having a function class that's not rich enough to accommodate the identity function, you basically hope to impose enough bias, right, to sort of simplify the model class enough so that you don't just learn the identity function. Okay? Other questions about this? Good. So here's a comparison of a particular autoencoder with PCA on a data set of faces. It's from this Hinton Salakudinov paper. They're both using the same dimensional latent code. Okay, so the input is basically the first row of images, of faces, right? And one of these rows is the neural network autoencoder, the other one is the PCA representation, right? And in fact, the autoencoder is the middle one, right? That sort of captures information better, right? Captures fine detail more accurately, more faithfully, arguably, than PCA, right? So in this case, PCA leads to these very smooth solutions here, right? That loses all the information about the edges, right? Loses the eyes here and so on, right? So really, the fine-grained features are not as well captured. Okay? And this is basically reconstructing the original data by going through the same dimensionality for the bottleneck, right? So the set that's sort of in the middle of the autoencoder is 30-dimensional in both of these cases. Okay? Now, the way to get there is quite a bit different, right? So one is just a simple PCA, linear mapping, to a 30-dimensional subspace, and the competitor is basically a multi-layer neural network autoencoder, right, a non-linear map. But if you sort of look at the smallest layer, right, so basically this latent code in the middle, it's the same dimensionality. Yeah?
How is exactly an autoencoder used
to? Sure. Sure. So there's lots of possible applications and different ways of using these things. So one is directly in applications, for example, like denoising. So for example, you can use these things, right? So with this intuition that we had before, right? So if there's sort of signal and there's noise in the quote-unquote orthogonal complement, right? Of course, everything is nonlinear. The hope is by having something that's almost like the identity, but not quite, you're able to sort of distinguish the noise from the real signal, right? So that's sort of, you can, for example, train these things, right, on noisy images to produce the non-noise, sort of noise-free images, and so on, right? That's sort of immediate application. So you can use this for fill-in, right? So there's blank, sort of occluded parts of the image, and sort of try to predict and hallucinate those, right? So that's sort of directly this reconstruction problem, right? But you can also use them in similar ways that we have discussed before, right? So dimensionality reduced visualizations, for example, right? So embed things in whatever, 2-3 dimensions and sort of do exploratory data analysis, do clustering. You can use it as features for subsequent supervised learning, right? So imagine you have a large data set of images where it would be maybe expensive to really annotate every single one of them. You can sort of hope to learn a good representation in an unsupervised manner. And then once you have this feature representation, the latent codes, right? You then have fewer parameters that you need to fit in a supervised learning task, right? You can hope to get away with fewer labeled data. So these are sort of some of the use cases, plenty more. So this is a very active topic, lots of different approaches.
So you would then only, one of those things only use one part of the F1 or F2?
Yeah, so for example, one thing is you could do, if you're on an unsupervised data set, right? You would train your your model, right? It's the encoder decoder, right? But then you sort of throw away the decoder, right? You just keep the encoder, and that's your phi of x, right? That's your feature map, right? And now maybe just train a linear classifier on that feature map, or sort of train a simpler neural net only on that feature map. Okay. Other questions? Okay. So there's certainly lots of use cases of that kind. Okay, so here, right, dimensionality reduction, sort of a similar picture. This is the for the MNIST dataset. What basically happens? So it's from the same paper. If you embed it just using PCA, you get this embedding on the left. And if you look at the two-dimensional visualization that comes out of this autoencoder, you get this visualization on the right, right? And so each of these colors here is a different digit, right? So it's 10 digits, handwritten digits from 0 to 9. Right, but the training the autoencoder is trained in a way without knowing those labels. Right, so you don't train a classifier. Right, it just trains to reconstruct those images, and then you plot the resulting latent code. Okay, and what you can see here is that you sort of have these more nicely defined, more nicely separated cluster by allowing this nonlinear embedding of your data. Okay, so that's basically That's basically the benefit visualization. Right now, if you were to visually inspect this, right, I could play that same game. I could ask you how many clusters are there, right? Maybe here you'd say something that's more sort of closer to 10 or something like this than if I were to ask you on the left plot, right? But that's sort of the usual issue with exploratory data analysis. How do you validate the resulting model? Okay, a quick demo just to show how to train these things in practice. So there's a little notebook. It's here. So I'm not going to... Okay, so you can let this run over the break, right? But basically, this is here a simple illustration of how to train an autoencoder using TensorFlow, and particularly using the Keras library on top of TensorFlow, right? So I think you've seen this before in the context of convolutional neural nets. And this is basically training an autoencoder on MNIST, on this handwritten digit data set that you've seen a few times now. And basically, what happens here is you sort of explicitly define an encoder and a decoder, right, as a dense layer. So it's a very simple kind of autoencoder. And concatenate those, right, that you use in order to define the model. You compile the associated computation graph, and then just fit it to the data, right, fit it to training data. Okay, and now you sort of extract just the encoder part, and you can then apply it to new data that you want to embed, right? And for example, compute the predict, apply the predict method on test data in order to find the latent code, right? The dimensionally reduced representation. Okay, and so you can train this model. So it's basically what happens if you call this fit method here. It's going to go through a bunch of epochs to train this neural net on the 60,000 samples from this endless data set. Runs 40 epochs, right, each using stochastic gradient descent. This shows here basically the progress of the loss on the training set as well as the validation set. And they both keep decreasing, right? So it would take a little longer to actually train, right? And here now it shows the original digits and the reconstruction that comes out of this autoencoder. Okay, so I'll post this online. You can actually try this. Okay, so I'll just sort of see how I can let it run over the break, right? So it takes a little while to train, right? Here you can sort of see it trained live now, right? But it's what I ran before. Okay, so let me just quickly wrap up here. Okay. So because this completes the dimension reduction part, right? So what you need to be able to is, so you need to understand PCA, be able to apply it both in the linear and kernelized setting, right? And you need to know what autoencoders are and be able to actually train them on data sets. So here's our summary slide. We didn't have that in a while. I created a new one here comparing some of the methods for supervised and unsupervised learning, right? So we started this course discussing least squares regression and classification, right, with the perceptron method. They're closely related. Basically, the only difference is the loss function. And now what we also did is, so I draw this arc here from regression, right, but of course you could apply to the classification as well, is that sort of you go from these linear methods to nonlinear ones by parameterizing the feature map, right, going to neural nets, right? So you could use neural nets for regression. And now we can sort of look at unsupervised analogs of these problems, right? Sort of the unsupervised analog in some sense of classification is clustering, right? We discussed the k-means method, and we discussed PCA as sort of the unsupervised analog of regression. They're closely related, sort of just slightly differences in terms of constraints. You can kernelize either of them, similar to what we did in, right? So this is what we discussed in supervised learning. We can apply the same in this unsupervised setting to get kernel PCA as well as kernel k-means. And now we can go the other route to get nonlinear functions to the sort of neural network route, right? And we'll end up with autoencoders as the neural network analog of kernel PCA. Okay, and also this our summary slides of sort of the different dimensions here. So before we had talked about supervised learning, but is now trying to put everything so far that we've discussed on this slide. because it didn't really change that much, right? We still talk about what kind of representations do we consider, right? What kind of functions do we consider? So linear hypotheses, nonlinear ones, and for the nonlinear ones, how do we reason about them? How do we represent them, right? The two main tools we discussed there were kernels on one end side with explicit feature maps and neural nets with feature maps that we would tune via optimization. This describes the class of hypotheses or models that we would consider, right? Now, once we agree on what kind of models we want to consider, we need to choose a preference among them, right? And we would do this by specifying a loss function plus regularizer. And now what we've introduced here, right, is the few unsupervised learning through compression, right, or reconstruction. That means we basically just think about it as a loss function, right? And we get supervision from the interpretation of unsupervised learning as this reconstruction problem. Okay? We have discussed a few more algorithms now, how to solve these problems, right? We discussed, for example, Lloyd's heuristic for solving k-means or another exact method, right, eigendecompositions for PCA. In terms of evaluation, we discussed that evaluation, validation in the unsupervised setting is quite a bit more complicated, but we've talked about that we can look at it through this lens of compression, so measuring how well a method does in terms of compression gives us sort of some way to think about model selection, right? Including methods like this elbow heuristic, right, or regularized quantization error and so on that we had discussed. Okay, so now let's take the break, and after the break, we'll continue with a new topic. Okay, anyways, so I want to start a new topic now. So what we've done so far in this course, as reviewed just before the break, is we've discussed some of the basic ideas in supervised and unsupervised learning. We've discussed how we can view the basic tasks in these settings, such as regression, classification, clustering, dimension reduction, as optimization problems, where we optimize over some family of functions or hypotheses for those that optimize some sort of cost function. Right? And we've seen how essential the choice of the cost function really is. Now, so far, these cost functions came a bit out of nowhere, right? We talked about the square laws, we talked about the hinge laws, and so on, but we didn't really justify them, right? We didn't really talk in too much detail about what each of these choices really means in terms of what assumptions you're making about our data. And so what I want to do in the next couple lectures is I want to study these assumptions in a bit more detail. So what we'll do is we'll take this optimization-based perspective on supervised and unsupervised learning and see how the choices that we've made actually correspond to making certain types of probabilistic or statistical assumptions on how the data is being generated. Okay? And this perspective will then lead us to discuss new types of loss functions you might want to consider in optimization, but also new perspectives how we should think about learning. So that's the plan for the next lectures on a very high level. Okay, so this is basically what we said, right? So far, we essentially just talked about families of functions, optimization criteria, and how to solve these resulting optimization problems. Now what we'll do is we'll look at how do these assumptions that we've made sort of translate to statistical assumptions that you're making about the data, which is a very natural way, will give us a very natural way to understand and diagnose whether we're actually making sensible assumptions, derive new models by changing our assumptions, basically, in a very natural manner, and think about ways as how do we actually quantify uncertainty in our prediction. Okay, and so the key idea is that we'll interpret essentially the methods we've talked about in terms of fitting certain probabilistic models, and then we'll discuss this family of models and how this will basically allow us to discuss a much richer family of learning methods. Okay? So what we've discussed for supervised learning, again, we'll start discussing this in the context of supervised learning, right? As we phrase supervised learning, right, in this following lens, we're given this data set of input-output pairs, and now we want to fit a hypothesis H mapping inputs to outputs, right? And we've discussed different families of such hypotheses. Right, so we started with linear ones, so H of X is W transpose X, and then we went to nonlinear ones imposed by kernels, right, where our H of X is something like sum over I alpha I times the kernel evaluated at XI, right, is sort of this dual representation in terms of our data points. Or we talked about neural network representations, right, where we now essentially have feature maps that we nonlinear parameterize somehow, right? And now among all of those, we wanted to find the one that minimizes the prediction error. And so the basic assumptions that we've made all along that I want to recall here, right, is that our data is drawn independently and identically distributed from some underlying data generating distribution P over input-output pairs, right? And one motivation that we've given to learning so far that I want to connect back to, so this is just refreshing our memories, is that we want to think about learning as this problem of minimizing our prediction error, right, empirical risk, for example, which might mean we want to minimize our loss function not on our data, our training data, but we want to minimize our loss function on examples we haven't seen, right? We want to have a small generalization error, right? We want to minimize our prediction error. Okay, and this is defined in terms of a loss function. And, right, so let's go back to the loss function we've seen many times throughout our course, namely the squared loss. It's the starting point for this investigation. And sticking with the squared loss, I want to ask two questions. So the first of all, we've talked about these different types of hypotheses, right? Linear ones, neural network-based ones, et cetera. How could we more generally think about what's the right set of functions you should be thinking about? And secondly, what I want to do is I want to talk about how does the squared loss translate to assumptions that you're making about our data. So let's start with the first topic and basically say if you really care about essentially this statistical perspective of learning, right, where we say we want to minimize our expected squared prediction error, right? So our risk is defined in terms of the squared error of our hypothesis on data that we haven't seen. Then we can ask what's even the best we can possibly hope for, right? What's the best possible classifier? So far, we made some arbitrary choices, right? Linear ones, right? Why neural nets, et cetera, right? So let's free ourselves of this kind of assumptions. Think about what's the optimal function we could consider. But in order to make this a well-defined problem, let's actually think about this unrealistic case where someone told us this data-generating distribution, right? So suppose we actually knew what is P of X, Y. Okay? And now we can ask what function H, among all possible functions you could consider, minimizes our squared loss. So let's write this down, right? So H star. So you want to minimize over all functions H the expected loss. They're drawn from P, right? Of our data points drawn from P. Of y minus, let me use capital letters for the random variables, y minus h of x, 2 norm squared. So that's the objective I would optimize. If someone told me what's the data generating distribution, right? What is really the joint distribution of x and y? It's the best I can hope for if this minimizing the squared prediction error is my desired performance metric, right? And now one thing is if we don't look at, don't have any constraints on the choice of our function, what does that mean? So it basically means in principle we can make a different prediction for each possible x, right? The only thing is we'll consider is still a function, right? In the end we'll still have a mapping that maps x to some label, right, some prediction. But you don't want to assume that it's a neural net, or don't assume it's a linear function. Okay? What this means is I can basically make a different decision, right? Specify the value h of x for each possible x, right? So I can basically get the same, so the same minimizer of all these functions is basically the expected minimum of x drawn from p of x, right, of the minimum of y, sorry, of minimum over h of x. And now what do I minimize here? Well, it's the conditional expectation of y of y minus h of x, which is the same objective that we had here before. And now it's a conditional expectation conditioned on the value of x. And why can we do this? Since we can pick h of x independently of h of x prime for x not equal to x prime, right? If you want to think about the optimal function, we don't have any constraint, right? So we can make a completely different decision between x and x prime, right? If you look at linear functions, of course, they're tied together. But if you don't have any constraints, you can make this decision completely independently of each other, right? So it means we can purely look at these sort of conditional decisions, conditioned on a given value of x. Okay, so let's forget about the distribution over x, right? We can really only focus on the optimization of what's the optimal prediction for a given x. Okay, so let's look at this in the next slide. Given x, what is the optimal prediction y hat? Right, so this is h of x, h star of x. Well, let me call it y star, right? So y star, it's h star of x. So what does this mean? Well, so y star is the arg min over all possible labels let me write y hat. And this is of x, right? Let me just be specific here, right? Of the expectation of y of y hat minus y. So y hat, this is my prediction. Capital Y is the random variable here. And this is a conditional expectation, conditional on the x, right? And here's the square loss. Okay? Is this clear? Right? So we're asking, in this ideal world, right, where we knew the data generating distribution, right? We knew p of x, y, right? And we wouldn't make any restrictions on our functions that we're considering, say for computational reasons, for example, right? What's the optimal prediction that we could make? That's what I want to work out. So what is this? Well, so one way to do this, so let's look at, let's define this here as L of y hat, right? And so this L of y hat is, let's just spell out what is this conditional expectation. So it's the integral over y hat minus little y, right? So y, capital Y is the random variable, right, as we had, and little y is the realization of it, right? Measured with respect to the distribution of a y given x, dx, and of course that's the square, right? And so now what you want to do is you want to find the optimal value of this, right? So what's the way to get the optimal value? As well, we could try to differentiate and set the derivative to zero, right? So let's look at d by dy hat of l y hat, right? Now, okay, without glossing over some technical details, right? Let's assume we can exchange the order of differentiation integration. Okay, so we have a nice density and so on, and we are, suppose we are allowed to do that. I will not discuss this in some more detail, right? So basically just get y hat minus y squared, p of y given x dx, right? And then this is just What do we get? Well, of course, it's a simple y hat minus y. P of y given x, dx. And now this means, right, that if I work this out here, right, we have so this here is supposed to be 0, right? I can just divide by 2, so let's get rid of this, right? So then we have the integral over y hat, probability of y given x dx is equal to integral of y p of y given x dx, right? And now, so this means that y hat needs to be equal to whatever is on the right here, right? So this first one here doesn't depend on y, right? So it's just a constant expectation of a constant number, right? That's just y hat. And that's supposed to be equal to this, which is just a conditional expectation of y given x equals little x. Okay? So it means if we care about the square loss, then the optimal thing that we can possibly do is to predict as y hat the conditional mean of our distribution, right? So if you didn't have any constraints on how h of x depends on x, so we can make a different decision for each x, and we knew this data-generating distribution, then the way to minimize our prediction error, really the true quantity that we care about, right, under the assumption that data is drawn ID from the distribution, right, in the setting that we've been discussing all along, is to predict the conditional mean of the data. Okay? So that's basically this, right? So the assumption, right, that our data is drawn ID from this distribution lets us conclude that the optimal predictor, right, in terms of minimizing the true risk for the squared loss, is basically this hypothesis H star, which for each x just evaluates as the conditional mean of y given x. Okay? And now this is a function, right, mapping x to some y, and it's really the best you can possibly hope for, right, under this setting that we're considering here. Right? Because it basically makes no restrictions on the function, and assumes that we already know the distribution that generates our data. Not just our training data, but the distribution of our test instances. Question?
Why a function on x? Why is it
a deterministic? Aha. So what we're saying is we're trying to fit a function, right? But the nature might not agree with being a function. Okay? So it could very well be, right, that for a given x, you get to see two different labels of y. So it might very well be that the true distribution actually has a deterministic relationship between y and x. You're just looking at this more generally. Right? But in this case, right, what you're saying, so it's a good question, right? So if it happens so that nature is deterministic, right, that y is in fact a function of x, then this conditional mean is just that value of x, of course. So it's a strict generalization of this. Okay? Good. And now this suggests sort of a natural strategy that we might want to think about choosing functions and optimizing over them, right? Namely, basically what we said is somehow if we could get our hands on this conditional distribution of y given x, right, then we would know how to make the best possible prediction. You just calculate the mean of that conditional distribution. That's what we just worked out. Okay? So that suggests a pretty natural perspective on learning. Well, maybe I should just try to estimate this conditional distribution. And of course, in practice, I'll never be able to perfectly estimate P of y given x, but I can try to fit it somehow, right? I can try to approximate P of y given x. And if I could do this, right, could do this well, get an accurate model of P of y given x, then I would make a minimal, would attain minimal risk. Right? So this suggests sort of a very natural way of thinking about deriving prediction rules, right? That comes out of the statistical perspective. Right? You started, right? So here, our notion of learning, right, is sort of you want to be able to make good predictions on examples that are drawn IID from some data generating distribution. And out came this as a recipe, right? If you really care about the square loss, we still haven't justified why the square loss, right? If you care about the square loss, then this is sort of the best thing you can do, right? And now we can sort of try to break down this further, right? How do we go about estimating P of y given x? And you can try to understand what does the square loss really mean. Okay, and now, how do you do this in practice? Well, so in principle, P of y given x could be some very complicated distribution, right? So now that is the place where we start to need to make some assumptions, right? Where we now somehow want to model and place specific assumptions of how we think about the data that's being generated. Right? So one natural way of essentially implementing the idea on the previous slide would be to now choose a particular parametric family of distributions of y given x, fit it to our data, and then predict the conditional mean. Right? That sort of is a pretty natural way of doing this. And of course, then it becomes a question of what kind of families of distributions I want to pick. And how do I go about fitting my parameters, right? And all it means we can now sort of look at standard probabilistic models as well as standard methods of parameter estimation, right? And so maybe the starting point for parameter estimation, right, is maximum likelihood estimation, in particular maximum conditional likelihood estimation. What is this? Okay, so what this would mean is basically we formulate a particular family of distributions, right, of y given x, and then we try to look for parameters that make our data or labels most likely given the observed x's, right? So we basically would say, so what is this, right? So this here is assuming IID data, this is just a product over I equals 1 through n of p hat of yi given xi and theta. Right? And so now, of course, what this means is that now theta star is equivalent, so instead of maximizing the likelihood, what we can do is we can maximize the log likelihood, right? So log of p hat of y1 through n given x1 through n and theta, which is by what we had above, just the sum argmax of the sum over I equals 1 through n of log of p hat of yi given xi and theta, right? And now this starts looking, sort of going a bit in the direction of what we had talked about before, right? So this is now a cost function optimization problem that we optimize over some parameters, right? And our cost function is a sum of a bunch of terms, right? One term per data point. This should look pretty familiar. Okay, now let's specialize this further. And in particular, let's look at the particular family, namely what's called a conditional linear Gaussian. So assume P of P hat, right, as our model of this conditional distribution of y given x and theta is a normal distribution. Right, we talk about regression, right? So we want to predict a continuous valued output. So let's take a density that places mass all over the reals, right? Let's say we use the Gaussian distribution. And now that's centered around h of x for some family, for some particular function h of x, and some variance, say, sigma squared. And in particular, let's consider, right? So this basically says here, the model, the distribution of our y as a Gaussian distribution centered around some h hat of x with some variance sigma square. And now we still have to commit what kind of h hat we would pick. So let's put h hat of x as a linear function. So let's model this as w transpose x. Right? Then basically, what we are saying is, we model p hat of y given x and theta and theta now, right? So the parameters are now w and sigma squared, right? It's a normal distribution. Let me use y, right? Centered at w transpose x with variance sigma squared. Okay, so this is now a particular choice, a particular modeling assumption that we've now imposed on how our labels are generated. Okay? And now then, this means that if we now optimize, sort of do maximum likelihood estimation, right? Get our parameters theta hat as the arg. Let me just spell out what we want to do, right? So w hat, let's for now even assume the sigma, okay, let's just assume sigma is known. Assume that this is known, right? So really the only parameter is w, right? The, sort of the mean function. Keep things simple, right? It's now the argmax over w of the log likelihood, right? So the sum I equals 1 through n of log p hat of yi given w transpose xi and sigma squared, right? And now that's the same, right? Okay, so this is basically what it would mean, right? If you now plug in a particular particular assumption, right, on terms of how we think about our labels being generated, right? You would model y given x as a Gaussian distribution centered around w transpose x with variance sigma squared. And now we can think about doing maximum likelihood estimation, right? Say with respect to the w's, or maybe w's and sigmas jointly, of our data. Right? That's sort of a pretty natural way of how we could think about trying to solve this prediction problem and then predicting the mean. Okay, so let's do this, right? And so basically, the conditional likelihood of our data so the log of the probability of y1 through n given x1 through n and w is, and let me actually look at the negative log likelihoods, which I can just minimize. So it's the min over the sum over I equals 1 through n of log And I can plug in the Gaussian distribution, right? So what's the Gaussian distribution? Well, I have 1 over square root 2 pi sigma squared of e to the minus yi minus w transpose xi squared divided by 2 sigma squared. That's just the Gaussian density that I plug in here, right? Now, what do we get? Well, let's simplify this a little bit here. So this, the log of this product here is just the sum of the logs, right? And this first term doesn't depend on I, so I just get minus n times the log of 1 over square root 2 pi sigma squared, the normalizer. And then I have minus log of e to the minus something, right? So the log and the exponential function are going to cancel, and the minus are also going to cancel, right? So I'm going to be left with plus the sum over I equals 1 through n of yi minus w transpose xi squared divided by 2 sigma squared. Okay? So that's the optimization problem that comes out of finding the parameters that maximize the conditional likelihood of our data under the assumption that our conditional density of y given x is the conditional linear Gaussian. And how does this optimization problem here look familiar? So let's think about one thing. So if we, what does this mean? Well, if you want to say arg max of w of p hat of y1 through n given x1 through n and w, then it's the same as arg min, for the reason that we had talked about before, of this expression, right? So that's star of star, which is the same as arg min. Let's inspect this once more, and this concludes what we want to talk about today. So the first term doesn't depend on w. The second term looks very similar to things we've seen, right? Namely, just the square loss, right? The cost function we would be optimizing for least squares regression, right? The sum of the square losses for data points only scaled by the variance. But if the variance is known, it doesn't matter for optimization, right? So sigma square doesn't matter. It can just take out, right? So this is basically just arg min, the sum over I of yi minus w transpose xi squared. Okay? All right? And now that's the problem that we started basically in the second lecture. Okay, so that means that we can rederive this problem of least squares regression from this perspective of trying to fit this conditional density, right? And in fact, then just predicting the mean of that conditional density, right? Because the mean of that Gaussian, right, if I fit this W here, is just W transpose xi, right? This now gives you a new perspective of what we are basically doing if you're solving the least squares regression problem. Okay, so that's sort of the simplest example of this, right? These squares always sort of, linear least squares are always are the simplest problems where you can illustrate these ideas. And what we'll do starting tomorrow and in the subsequent lectures is much more expand on these ideas, right? To basically reinterpret things that you've done throughout this course through such a similar probabilistic perspective, and using these ideas to derive neural learning algorithms. Okay? So see you tomorrow.